I have the unenviable position of speaking at 8:30 in the morning in Toronto. As I was mentioning earlier this morning, this is never an ideal time slot for Toronto. We have a tendency to want to sleep in or get stuck on the GO train coming in here in the morning. So I'm here today to talk to you about influence marketing. And I was asked to do so, actually, maybe because I'm just such a good-looking guy, I wake people up, or so scary that I wake people up. I don't know what the answer is, but I suspect it's probably because I co-authored the book, Influence Marketing, with my buddy Danny Brown a little while ago. And it started to create some waves. It challenged the industry 2 years ago, and thankfully, it's still selling really well. It's still getting a lot of attention. In fact, we are now teaching this book as a text at Seneca College here in Toronto in their post-grad program. So that's some of the insights that I want to share with you today, but I also want to share with you some of the things that have happened in the last 2 years in terms of this industry. So the first question that I think we all probably have, and this is why I still ask myself sometimes, even though this is the industry that I am in, you know, why the heck are we still talking about influence marketing? Like, really? Isn't it over? I thought clout was done. Why are we still talking about this? And it's funny because you get, well, there's an article, I'll just start there. There's an article about a month ago, less than a month ago, that I'm sure many of you have read. It was in Gawker magazine by Sam Biddle. And he basically came out and said, thank the Lord, influence marketing is dead. All right, so that's his quote up there. The entire article was about the collapse of influencer marketing, and I'm focusing on that word purposely, influencer marketing. And as he says up here, it's collapsing. Fantastic, because it was all a bullshit enterprise to begin with. Right? So was it really a bullshit enterprise? When we really do get a lot of positive feedback. So let's make sure we know what we're talking about first. Here's one example of somebody that has become quite well known in the influencer marketing industry. He's making a decent living for himself, right? You can take a look at this example where he posts, I put up a billboard for White Girl Wines in Soho. He takes his typical off-the-cuff, somewhat irreverent, many times bawdy, type of content and images, and he puts it out there, and he gets paid for this because he's built up quite a large following. Michelle Phan is another one that you might know. Michelle Phan is somebody that I worked with at another client, Ringling College of Art and Design. She dropped out of college, dropped out of art college, said, I'm not going to make a career as an artist, but I'm going to make YouTube videos about makeup. So she started doing that, built up a good following, I guess taking some of the creativity that she learned at Ringling College of Art and Design, and now makes a decent living through sponsored posts and sponsored ads inside of her videos to her hundreds of thousands of followers on YouTube each week. So this is influencer marketing, social celebrity, building up a large audience and getting paid for your ability to build up that large audience. And this is the industry that Gawker has declared is dead and was a bullshit industry to begin with. Is it? Oh. Right? If it is, why are we still seeing in the last couple of months articles like this all over the media? And not just in blogs, in mainstream media as well. CEOs, CMOs are still looking to influencer marketing, are still spending money in influencer marketing, because they think it will get them someplace. So is it really dead? Is it really a bullshit bullshit industry? And then there's the hundreds of agencies that are developing to focus on influencer marketing right around the world. Some here in Toronto, you've got some here from Australia, France, all over the place. You can throw up my own agency there as well, because that is part of what we do. So many people are trying to capitalize on this. Some claim they are capitalizing on that. Right? CMOs, CEOs are all saying they want to spend money on it, and yet the industry is supposedly dead. Why the contradiction? So in DigiDay, they have a great series called Confessions. And they, this past month, asked an executive, a marketing executive that actually hires influencers and agencies that represent influencers, and they asked them, what do you think about this industry? And this is what actually spawned that Gawker article. And what he said is influencers are going to start disappearing. Brands are going to start realizing the amount of followers you have doesn't mean shit. Just because photos look good and have 200,000 followers means nothing. Amen. I love that. I was jumping for joy in front of my phone when I was reading this. I believe that. Not everybody does. Go back to the previous slide. Now, you might also be asking yourself, well, hold on. Didn't you say that you do influence marketing? So how does this work? So that's what we're here to talk about. But first, we want to talk about what went wrong. Influencer marketing, or influence marketing, the term that I prefer to use, and I'll explain why in a minute. And it's a little hint. It's because it's the name of my book, and it's good for SEO value. I'll put that right out there. But there is actually a more technical reason for it. We have to understand what went wrong to know why we need to move forward or how we can move forward with this, okay? So for those of you that know me, you might know where I'm starting, right? Mm-hmm. And I promise I will only talk about clout once. This is where it started. Companies like clout, for as much as they are loved or hated, started measuring people's influence and started giving people scores. This is where it started to go downhill. So before the industry even built up, it started on the wrong foot. Now they've evolved. This is a screen capture from their current site. And let me tell you what's wrong with this. Take a look at this line right here. When you share something on social media or in real life and people respond, that is influence. Is it? I don't know where you all went to school, but in my books, that's a conversation. I talk to you, you respond, that's a conversation. That is not influence. So what does the next line say? Take a look. The more influential you are, the higher your clout score. So based on their own definition, the more conversational you are, the more influential you are. Does anybody see a problem with this? Now they've evolved. And they said, we're no longer just going to rank you. We're going to help you get a higher score. We're going to help you become influential. Now, here's a friend of mine, Peg, who posted this. And I'm not picking on her. She just happened to be the first person that came up in my stream this week when I was customizing this deck. And take a look at what it says there. How to successfully market content across social media. And then clout.tt. That tells you that this is an article that Clout suggested she should post. Now, why would Clout suggest that you post something? Go take a look at their platform today, and what they're going to tell you is that we're going to help you become influential. We're going to tell you what to post, when to post, if you want to be influential in specific topics. So, what's happening here? They're trying to make influencer. Instead of you being an influencer, because you love a product, because you use a product, because you've got some form of expertise, they're trying to help you fake it. They're doing the work, and they're just trying to help you elevate yourself. Why? Because it's self-serving. Good for them. They're a business. I applaud businesses that make money. I love that. But this is where we've gone wrong. So we're going to share a couple of problems with social influencers throughout the course of this presentation this morning. And the first is that being an influencer has become an industry unto itself. Okay? Influence is no longer a byproduct of you being actually good at something. It is no longer a byproduct of you loving a product and using a product and sharing it because you just love it. No. Now it's all about, I want to be famous. It's an ego-driven industry. And people are starting to get savvy. Finally, we're catching wind of what's really going on here. So that's one of the problems. But what is influence marketing? So first of all, I want to stop using the term influencer marketing. It's influence marketing. And to me, as a business professional, somebody who's been in this game for a long time, somebody who's had to stand in front of the CEO and justify the money that I'm being paid to do certain jobs. To me, influence marketing is the practice of one person swaying the purchase decision of another in the favor of a business, of a product, of a brand. There's an implied action there. All right? The action is the swaying of someone's purchase decision, getting them to buy something that they might not otherwise have bought. Now, you just can't do that with social celebrity. Why is that? So going back to this DigiDay article, this confession of a marketing executive, when asked what went wrong, he said, we threw too much money at them and too quickly. In 2014, they were getting paid $500 to show up and take some photos. Then it became $1,500. Now it's hundreds of thousands of dollars. And it's true. I work with some of them. I can tell you that that's the going rate. And when asked, well, how do you justify that? What kind of guarantee do I get? When I hire talent, when I go to a talent agency, there's an insurance policy that I get. If they don't deliver what they say they're going to deliver, I'm covered. Try asking an influencer on Instagram today to give you some kind of insurance or guarantee. Ask them to say, what kind of dollars are you going to drive from my business to justify me giving you $200,000? It's not going to happen. It won't happen. They'll say, well, look, I got 200,000 followers. I'm going to get you lots of retweets. I'm going to get you lots of mentions, lots of eyeballs. Right? That just doesn't cut it anymore. So I'm going to suggest that this isn't even the problem. Okay, I just told you that there's a problem. That's not the crux of the problem. What's the crux of the problem? Okay, so I'm going to share this with you. But I'm going to unveil the curtains on influence marketing for you as somebody who's been in this industry since the very beginning, somebody who wrote the book on it. But I'm going to hide over here simply because this has a tendency to get marketers to throw their phones at me or tomatoes. So I'm going to hide right back here. Okay, so here's the secret. Okay, all of you, marketers ruin everything. And I will include myself in that because this is what I do for a living. Is that you, Sheldon? I can see you. Yeah, you. Ruin everything. Ruin everything. Why do we ruin everything? Because we're looking for a quick fix. We're looking to justify ourselves. We're looking to make money fast. We're looking to become the next influencer. We're looking to get the followers. But we don't want to justify our expense. So we're looking for something quick. We always grasp onto the next technology. Why? Because we want to be the first to market with that. We want to be able to write the book because we got the first 50,000 followers on Vine. So we can now get that book deal. We do whatever we can to sell something without any thought to the long-term play. And it's an epidemic in this industry. So what happened specifically with influence marketing? How did we start to kill it? Well, first of all, we invented astroturfing, okay? Astroturfing is, for those of you that don't know, astroturfing is the practice of businesses getting their staff or other people to give positive comments about their business on Yelp and those types of review sites, because we know that 5 stars, the more we have of these, the better it is, right? That's what we want. We want to get it out there. So what happened? They got wise because we started using technology to do this, right? There was a big case a couple of years back in New York State where the Attorney General sued and successfully shut down these practices with companies posting, like there was a big group of lawyers that all got together and started posting positive reviews about each other, right? So all of a sudden that trust, this authenticity that social media was built upon, said, yeah, social media is all about authenticity. How many of you have used that line in a tweet, right? Everybody, including myself. But is it really authentic when we're doing this kind of crap? So we can't do this anymore because now you get sued. Now Yelp has technology that determines whether this is a real person or not. So what did we do? We moved off to cyber shills. Now we've got this spycraft game going. So now when a marketer is hired by a brand to promote their product, or somebody wants to build themselves up as an influencer and needs followers, what do? Okay? We can't use technology anymore. Heaven forbid we actually become an expert at something. I mean, heaven forbid we actually do some work. No, what we do is we now go as agencies, we go and hire companies in China who have hundreds of thousands of people sitting in front of their computer and get paid a couple of pennies per profile to come and comment positively on your product. They're real people, it's a real account, and it's actually cheaper in some cases than using the technology. Now, I'm not picking on China, these companies are all over the world, they just happen to be the largest factories out there. So we've got this whole spycraft thing going on now. So how authentic is that? So you've got a lot of five-star reviews on your Apple Play or on your Google app. Yelp says you got a lot, so what? You got a lot of followers on Twitter, so what? Most of them are fake. Most of them have been earned the wrong way. And then there's the Kardashians. I don't even know where to begin with this one. Influencer factories, the Kardashian effect. Your 14-step roadmap to becoming an influencer, step-by-step guide to becoming an influencer in your industry. As I said earlier, we are now becoming an industry where we build up fake social celebrities, and we pretend that that means something. Now, this is not just bloggers and influencers. These are mainstream media's respected publications that are talking like this because they know this is what gets audience. This is what gets clicks. People want to be influencers. They want to be famous. Why? Because you got people like the Kardashians who have made a business out of just being famous. But does it actually work? Right? I teach influence marketing at Seneca College right now. Any SMD 204s in here? I know I saw some of you outside. One student who took our post-grad program said to me, I took this course, and it was a year-long course, to say, because I wanted your course in particular, because I want to learn to be an influencer. I go, really? Okay. Because I might be able to help you. What are you expert at? Not really anything. I go, what? So how am I going to make you an influencer if you don't really know anything? He goes, well, that's what I'm hoping you're going to teach me. He says, hold on, I'm going to analyze the industry for you. I'm going to teach you how to hire other people who might be an influencer. And they go, oh, you won't make me an influencer? No. So, okay, and dropped out. Right? That's real case here this past year. So I want to be an influencer, the millennial generation. And people my age that are just have egos this big. Right? There's lots of us out there, trust me. So let's break this down. Why is this the case? The first thing we need to take a look at is what brands typically do. So a brand will look at their audience, right? So this is a representation of their social graph. They'll take a look and say, okay, how many people in here can I find as an influencer? But before they do that, they figured, we now know that there's something called content marketing. So what do? We take this audience, and now we say we're going to post YouTube videos because we all know we've been told that YouTube videos are very effective. So we start producing videos all the time. Then what do? We go to Facebook, we use mobile technologies, and we start producing specific content for social networks, and we build up an even bigger community of people there, and we post more content. Then what do? We say, well, that's not enough. Now we got to start blogging. So we're going to blog. We're going to start posting articles, and we're going to write white papers. We're going to put them on our website. And then what? Well, you know what? Email is not dead yet. There's a lot of evidence that email is still an effective communication tool. So we're going to create an email marketing campaign. We're going to use automated marketing automation software, and we're going to now start sending drip emails based on people's experiences with our product, or when they tweet us, they're going to get something sent back to them. What have we just done here? All of this content is getting piled up and crammed into our phones and into our computers. The scourge of content marketing. Now, I'm not saying content marketing is a bad thing. What I am telling you is that we all, as marketers, what do marketers do? We ruin everything. We market, right? Oh, content marketing, we gotta start publishing like crazy. right? I've been to a lot of these conferences where I get people telling me, well, you got to post 3 times a day at least if you want to see, you know, volumes and you want to get crowd. You got to get so many people writing for you. There's all these formulas that people come up with to produce more content and get more followers, right? It's said that there is 2 million blogs published each day. And that doesn't include the content that we're writing in social networks, the videos that we're producing, the Vine videos that are going up. There is so much content out there. We have created a mess. And then let's not even talk about the devices, right? Because now we have devices that talk to us, right? We have our Fitbits, we have our refrigerators are telling us when to eat and when we've opened the fridge too much. We're just constantly being inundated with content. So how can you actually cut through that clutter? How many people are influencers when everybody's practicing to be an influencer? Everybody's building up these fake following bases. Everybody's being paid to share something. The internet has become too big. The internet is too crowded for influence marketing. So let's go back to the brands. So the brand says, okay, well, that's not going to work because we know we built up these audiences. And inevitably, and this happens to me all the time, a CMO will stand up, or worse, the CEO will stand up at the end of a year, and this is a conversation I have had myself. So actually, I'll get very personal. I had a client in New York City who I'd been working with for about 5 years, very, very successful campaign. We built an advocate program for them, and they said, Sam, we get the most positive feedback from this program. This was the CEO of the largest financial institution in the world. Stood up and said, I cannot believe the work that you guys have been doing. It's phenomenal. I get emails every week about how great this is. I said, woof, yeah, because this was November and it was time we were talking about getting approval for next year's budget. So I was excited. Then he said, so, can you tell me how much money you've made me? And then we looked at each other, my partner and I, and the client, our contacts went white because they had no clue. So then I said, okay, give me a sec. And I pulled out the reports. I was prepared for this. Most people aren't. And this is why very few agencies keep a client as long as they do, because they have a hard time, marketing agencies have a hard time justifying how much money they've made the client. They know how many tweets they've generated. They know how many impressions they've drawn. They know how many followers they've gotten. But inevitably, that question will come. How much money have you made me? What's the ROI on this campaign? This is what we need to get to. So what the brands are saying now is, okay, well, I got an influencer. Maybe they can cut through the clutter. Let them do the work, right? So they'll tell 2 friends, who then tell 2 friends, so on and so on, all right? For those of you old enough like me, you'll remember Heather Locklear in the commercial. Mm-hmm. Give me a minute, Heather Locklear. Heather Locklear, she was a stunner. Anyway, I'm back. Never mind, I digress. So what happened? We thought if we could do this, tell 2 friends, tell 2 friends, tell 2 friends, what's going to happen? Right? The money's going to start rolling in. Woohoo! Dollar bills for everybody. Right? Because that's what happens when you hire influencers. Money just starts pouring in, right? As if. As if that actually would happen. None of us would be here trying to learn something. We'd all be in a little hut in Fiji being served by Polynesian women. So who should you focus on? We're still talking about influence marketing. How about focusing on the customer? Right? Those of you that have been in the industry more than a few years like me, or a lot of years like me, what are you going to do? Focus on the customer. More importantly, focus on buying customers. And start there. What a novel approach. I want to gain customers, so I'm going to get influencers who have got this massive social following to drive me customers. Do you even know who your customers are? Do you even know if they're in the buying cycle? So let's go back a little bit and let's talk about some basic marketing, which too many social media marketers forget or maybe have never learned. David Ogilvy, great man, one of my heroes in this industry, said advertising is not an art form. Okay, it is a medium for information, a message for a single purpose, to sell. Marketers get pissed when I say this. Even PR people get pissed when I say this. We are here to sell a product. If we can't justify our work and we can't link our work to actually selling a product, what good are we? Right? A slightly different spin on that same quote came from the head of marketing for Coca-Cola, which is the purpose of marketing is to sell stuff. That's been quoted over and over and over again. So that's what we're here to do, right? But are we doing that with influence marketing and all the money that is being spent on this? Right? Remember this? We go back. Influencers are going to start disappearing. Brands are going to start realizing the amount of followers you have doesn't mean shit. Right? I bring that back up again because this is what's happening. The number of followers you have is great. You get eyeballs, but if you're not driving sales, what are you going to do? How is it working for you? Connecting these spray and pray, what I call spray and pray influence marketing campaigns, does not connect with ROI, or very rarely does. And if it does, there's that whole causation thing. Is it causation or is it correlation? Are you causing your sales to go up because of this campaign, or does it just happen to be there because other things in the market are working this way for you? So this is what we want to do. How do we start using influence marketing now for ourselves? Okay, so the first thing, remember we said, let's look at these influencers, right? So if a brand takes an influencer, we identify who that person is. We don't want to do that anymore. Let's change our social graph. Let's stop looking at what influencers do we have in our community, and let's look at our social sphere of customers. And let's pick out an existing customer. And then, from there, let's take a look at their social graph. So let's start analyzing their social graph. If you use a product like Sysomos, for example, this can be quite easy to do. So you take a look at that. Now, why do you want to do that? When you look at the customer social graph there's something really interesting that happens. And this is an exercise that Danny Brown and I did. We took about 8 months to analyze 50 clients. What we did is we took a look at their social graphs. Then we picked out customers from within their social graph, and we started analyzing the following of those customers. Who were they talking to online? And then we took a look at their influencers and said, now who within their influencer community, let's take a look at their social graph and let's see who follows their influencers that they're hiring. And what's the makeup of that audience? And we found something really interesting. On average, 40% of the followers of these so-called influencers were fake, okay? Or non-customers, people that would never actually buy their product. Right? So we took them out. So let's just get rid of them completely because they're never going to buy the product. So if I got an influencer saying buy this product, 40% won't buy. 30% on average were already customers. Says, well, what's the purpose of me telling them to buy something if they already have it? So let's get those guys out. And who's left? We analyzed a little bit further and we discovered 20% were potential prospects that could buy the product, but they weren't in the buying cycle then, at that time. So these were people that we would advertise to, we would try and get them to buy, but they're not ready to buy right now, for whatever reason. So that left us with 10%. 10% on average was the number of people within a influencer's following, in their social graph, that could potentially buy something. So what you find with these, when we analyzed the dollars that they were spending on influence marketing campaigns, they were spending a lot of money for very little return. There's got to be a better way, we said to ourselves. There has to be a better way. So let's take a look at that. So there's one other thing that I'm going to share with you. I'm going to pull the curtains back one more time, okay? Calling out the BS in this industry. Guess what? Consumers control whether they're influenced or not. The influencer has absolutely nothing to do with it. Okay, I'm going to repeat this again. This is one of my final messages and really important. Consumers control whether or not they are influenced. Who you hire as an influencer has very, very little to do with it. Right? And it's this push-pull thing that happens. We can hire an influencer to go out and push people to say, you got to look at this product. I love this product. Here, I'm paid to look at this product. Right? And what's happening right now, by the way, I don't know if you guys have been keeping up with the news. In Australia right now, they're actually mandating that anybody paid or incentivized in any way, monetary or otherwise, to talk about a product has to disclose that, even in a tweet, that this is paid for. There's a hashtag PAY or hashtag PAYT, I think it is. Anyway, so they have to always disclose it, or they could get sued or fined by the government. And this is something that's starting to roll now across other countries. So if you're paid to talk about something, what's the value of that? Consumers today are opening themselves up to influence. Why? You know these statistics already, but I'm going to share them with you just for a point. 52% have always plan and research before they buy. This is a study that was just released this year. 80% spend a lot of time researching before they buy. 59% only buy what others have tested or bought. So we still rely on research when we're about to go buy something. So if that's the case, we're not just going to randomly see a tweet about how great a product is and then go buy. No, we go looking for advice. So we are opening ourselves up to that influence. So it's only when the consumer is ready to buy are they going to be influenced. So if you've got an influencer out there who's saying, I just got 200,000 followers, you're going to pay me $30,000 to talk about your product. Well, who cares? Are they ready to buy? Are they ready to be influenced? That's what we need to, the point that we need to get to. Okay? Influence starts only when a consumer makes a conscious decision to purchase or to move along that customer journey. And that's the other point that I want to highlight. I'm not going to get into the details because then, you know, you come to Seneca and take my course, but or buy my book, better yet, available on Amazon. What we could talk about here is that there are different stages. Influence marketing doesn't have to be to just get somebody to be aware of a product or just to get them to buy a product. You can create campaigns that get people to move along from the purchase to becoming an advocate. There are many stages and different campaigns that could work. So that Michelle gave me a wonderful introduction, said it's not just an art, I've got this down to a science. And I've been in this business long enough to have gotten this down to a science. And we can do this, and how does that work? So let's break down real influence marketing. First of all, what generates influence over buying customers? Well, a great report was just released called the Influence Marketing Report. What they discovered when analyzing consumers across North America is that the number one driver of influence for customers is peer-to-peer word of mouth. Now, that's me talking to Alan, saying, I like this product. He says, okay, Sam, I trust you. I know you're an expert in cameras, or I know you're an expert in cigars. And then he'll then go ahead and say, I'm going to trust that. I'm going to go buy one because I want one. Or it could be on social media. The point, the key word there is peer-to-peer, person-to-person, people that I know. Traditional media came in at 22%, and in-person experiential events, 18%. That actually is really important. That's topic for another full presentation that we can do, the value of experiential marketing in terms of developing influencers. But now let's take a look at the second group that came in at only 14, 13, and 12. These are our social channels. Digital social influencers, online media, online communities. Take a look at the difference. Today, despite all the money that is being paid to influencers, peer-to-peer, old-fashioned word of mouth is still the number one influencer of purchase decisions. So how do the Kardashians play into that? Right? Perfect example right here. Well, actually, I'm going to save that example for a minute. So the first group, the blue group, that's who I call micro-influencers. Micro-influencers are people that we talk to every day that we have some kind of a defined relationship with. These are the people that actually have the ability to influence a purchase decision. The second group, right, those are our macro-influencers. Those are the people that can spray a message potentially far and wide, help with potentially general PR, but can they actually sell something? Without that first group, without the micro influencers, you cannot make it happen. So let's break that down, okay? Remember the consumer? So we found a customer. Now let's take a look at who they're talking to, right? Another example that we cite in our book. When you take a look at the consumer's social graph, what you're able to do, especially when you're using tools like Nimble or Sysomos, great tools out there, you can now start to define relationships between that person and group people within their social graph by listening to the conversation. All right? There's some phenomenal tool, natural language processing, that's built into all of these tools right now. Is phenomenal. We can now start to say, okay, this person talks to these people, and they're typically parishioners based on their stated relationship and their profile or the nature of their conversation. This other group are family members, and they're talking about this product in this way, defined by this relationship. Another group might be friends. Again, based on their profile settings, what groups they belong to together, or the nature of the conversation. Another group might be coworkers. Right, so this is one that I studied in depth. And what we did here is, if you take a look at this group of coworkers, I'm going to remove everybody else. And then we took a look at the frequency at which this group of micro-influencers communicated with the customer, the person who bought from us. Right? And we took a look at the words. What words were they using? Words like collaboration, pricing, support. So they're using all of these words. So we start to develop a bit of a profile around what is this person using to talk about this product. Where are they in the life cycle stage? Are they the consideration, the desire, the need? All of a sudden, we have context. Context is a beautiful word. This context now allows us to define influence marketing campaigns. It allows us to determine what is going to sway a consumer's purchase decision. So let's look at what that might look like in actual practice. So now that we have this sort of working backwards, we can go to a brand like Apple, Bell, Starbucks, Bic Pens, whoever we're working with. We can go to them, and now we can say, okay, I know the macro influencer, and I'm going to recommend that that should be typically a media outlet, a large blog, as opposed to an Instagrammer. We now know that these guys could potentially deliver content or promotion that not only sprays a message to a large group, but is targeted to a very specific cohort. Now, because we've done our research and we understand the language between different cohorts or different subgroups of that cohort, we can now start to look at different groups within there, right? So we've got all these different groups. Now we can say, okay, this is the message that I want. When you do this, we've proven that you could actually measure the bottom line effect of these campaigns. And when you can do that, now all of a sudden you can say, all right, I'm going to go back to that same macro influencer, or I'm going to tweak my campaign, or I'm going to do something else. Most importantly, when the CEO finally stands up and says, okay, great campaign, I love it, lots of media, what money did you make me? Now you can do it. Now you can do it. Right? Now, are Instagrammers, are famous Instagrammers completely useless? No. Absolutely not. You might find somebody, depending upon your industry, depending upon your product, depending upon your audience, depending upon who those micro-influencers are, that are actually having conversations about purchases or at a point when your consumer is ready to buy. At that point, they might come in handy. My recommendation, though, is if you've got somebody that is that good at building up that kind of an audience, hire them. Don't hire them to be an influencer. Hire them. Make them write content for you. Have them do custom videos for you that you put on your channel. Don't pay them $30,000 to take a product shot. That's insane. Hire them for $10,000 to write content for you. Much better use. And then you own the content on top of that. Right? The point here is that the internet is too big. There is too much content. There are too many people saying that they're influencers, that for influenced marketing or influencer marketing to actually work. It doesn't, right? It's just too big, it can't work anymore. But it can if you know how to cut through the clutter. And I'm gonna tell you why. And here's my final point of my session this morning. Right, I can see the timer getting all twitchy over here because there's a coming out. So this is my final point, I promise. It's something called dyadic relationships. Now, a dyad is a group of two. Right? That's all it is. It sounds like a big fancy word. It means two people and the relationship between those two people. Okay, now why is that important? Let me share an example with you. Telenor. Telenor is a telecommunications company similar to TELUS or Rogers here in Canada, but of course they're in the Scandinavian countries, Russia, Northern India. They're huge. They were trying to sell iPhones into this market because they've become really big in North America, in the United States in particular. They figured, okay, there's got to be something here. So they tried to bring it over, and they tried to sell the iPhones into their communities, and it wouldn't work. They could not get any traction. Nokia was always going to be, and then at the time, even BlackBerry was always going to be the number one phone over there. So what did they do? They tried influencers, right? And they started giving phones to celebrities in those communities and having them photographed. Still would not make a difference. So they started bringing over the pithy advertising and the clever advertising that they had here in the United States over there, put them on the television, didn't work. They even tried the I'm a Mac, I'm a PC kind of thing, did not work. So what did? They commissioned a study. They said, we want to look at everybody within our territory. Let's run a survey, we're going to talk to everyone, we're going to say, okay, you're a customer, what phone do you have? And then they said, now tell us 10 of your closest friends and what phones they have. And the results were fascinating. What they found is that within this social graph of your closest friends, if one of your friends had an iPhone, you were 2 times as likely to also own an iPhone. But if 2 people within your social graph of your closest friends had an iPhone, you were 14 times more likely to own an iPhone yourself. So what does that tell us? That tells us there is a power in dyadic relationships, right? This Fitbit on my wrist is a perfect example. 2 years ago, I attended the CES show in Las Vegas, and all anybody was talking about was wearable tech. Everybody was talking about it. It's like everywhere, your shoes, your hat, your shirt, your backpack, everything is connected. I've been seeing that. Robert Scoble and I had an argument on this 2 years ago there. He says, I don't know, it's not going to be that big. And he goes, Sam, this is everything. Now, he's an influencer in this community. I didn't buy anything. You know when I got this wearable tech? March, on my March break with my kids. Why? Because a friend of mine was there running, and she says, look at this app, Sam. Look how many steps I took today. I bet you can't beat me. I go, I bet I can. So she showed me the app. She goes, she invited me to join her community. And so I said, oh, I'm going to beat you. So I went and bought one. Why? Because a friend of mine asked me to join her personal community, and we've now got a peer-to-peer connection over this. That's what finally got me to buy it. And I'm sure a lot of you can relate to that and have your own examples. All right? So if you're going to tweet anything, if you're going to write down anything, this is it. For marketers, the bigger the internet and social networks become, the more valuable those one-to-one connections are. The internet is too big for mass marketing. Build your communities. Build those large communities. That's awesome. Do it if you can. But then mine those communities for those one-to-one relationships, because that's where the gold is. That's where you can actually sway purchase decisions. Not through mass spray and pray influence marketing campaigns. So I hate it when I attend a lecture or a seminar and they don't give me some kind of an actionable blueprint at the end. So I don't have a lot of time here, but what I'm going to tell you is I'm going to leave you on this message. Reverse engineer influence. Don't start with the influencer. Remember, you want to be successful at influence marketing, start ignoring influencers. Start with your customer and do your research to find out what micro communities do they belong to? Who are they talking to? What are those conversations? Where are they along the customer journey? Know your customer journey. And then identify your macro influencers. And once you've done that, then, and only then, can you actually look at mass influencers to work back towards the customer because you have that blueprint. So thank you very much, everybody. I really appreciate you waking up early this morning. Thank you.